वाष्मे न जीवामि तया विना इति विज्ञाय राधे तं नयमाम चरणं भक्त्या विहीनाय अपराध लक्ष्य चित्ताश्च कामादि तरंग मध्ये कृपामयि त्वं शरणं प्रपन्ना वृंदे नुमस्ते चरणारविन्द।
फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल my heart touching obeisances in the lotus feet of my spiritual master nitya lila pravishta om vishnu pad shri simad bhakti pragyan keshav goswami and same in the lotus feet of my shiksha guru om vishnu pad shri simad bhakti vedanta swami। I want to remind you that what is bhakti, and you should judge by your heart that whether you are heartily following the principles of bhakti or not. So you know in Srimad Bhagavat definition of bhakti has been given. In other, also in his scriptures, it has been given. But Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu associate Srila Rupa Goswami has given the definition of bhakti, which contains all the previous definitions, and that is anna bhilashita shunyam gyan karmadhyana vritam anukullena krishna anushilanam bhakti uttam. I've told so many times, but still I'm today reminding you what is bhakti. Aranya Maharaj should explain in brief.
Umajanati marandhasa jnanandana salakya chakshur anvale chamjena tasmai shri gurave namaha. So Srila Gurudev ordered me to speak briefly about the unprecedented definition of bhakti that was written down by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu under the direct inspiration of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and written down by Rupa Goswami Pad. Anyabhilashita shunyam jnana kamadhyana vritam anukulyena krishna anushayam bhaktir uttama. The unbroken, uninterrupted cultivation of all endeavors of one's body, mind and words, and also of sentiments of the heart, which are meant exclusively for the benefit of Sri Krishna, which are completely devoid of the slightest trace of any other desire, and which are not covered by karma, the tendency to perform reward-seeking activity, jnana, the cultivation of knowledge for the purpose of attaining liberation, and yoga, the cultivation of mystic power, dry renunciation, etc. Such a constant, unbroken cultivation of all endeavors of the body, mind and words is called Uttama Bhakti.
Yes, yes. Some explanation.
Hare Krishna, there is a speaker in the Prasadam hall for all the children who want to compete with the lecture.
What, what?
So Srila Gurudev ordered me to give little explanation. So far we've explained the translation only. Now a brief explanation. The verse can be divided into two parts. Anyabhilashta shunyam jnana kamadhyanavritam. And then the second part, Krishna anushilanam bhakti, anukulyena Krishna anushilanam bhakti uttama. The first part defines the tatastha lakshan of bhakti, that means the extrinsic characteristics of devotion. It explains what devotion isn't. Whereas the second part defines the swarup lakshan, the intrinsic characteristics of devotion, that defines what devotion actually is. So first we'll look at that. Anukulyena Krishna anushilanam. The entire verse revolves around the word shilanam. Shil dhatu means a cultivation. So bhakti is not something static. It is not like gyan, knowledge, but it's kriyatmik, it's an activity. And so the shil dhatu, this verb, refers to cheshtarup, the endeavors that one performs, and also bhavarup, or the concomitant emotions which accompany those endeavors. So when we examine the cheshtarup aspect of shilanam, we find that it has two parts, that is called the nivriti atma cheshtarupa and pravriti atmaka cheshtarupa. Nivriti atmaka cheshtarupa means that in bhakti we'll have to be very careful and make a conscious, energetic endeavor to avoid those things which are not favorable for devotion, such as atyahara priyasas cha prajalpo niyamagraha janasangas chaloyam cha sadvi bhakti vinashati. Overeating, over endeavoring, speaking mundane things, being greedy for worldly achievements and association of materialistic persons. Also, we have to be very careful to avoid things such as nam aparad, being inattentive at the time of chanting, and 10 other types of nam aparad, including Vaishnava aparad, making offenses to other devotees, and guru avagya, neglecting or disrespecting the spiritual master. All of these things, because actually the three modes of material nature, they by force they engage us in these things, and therefore we have to make concerted energetic effort to avoid them. So that is called nivritti atmaka chestarupa, the endeavor to give up those things that which will be detrimental for our devotion. Then, pravritti atmaka chestarupa means to accept everything which is favorable. So that means utsahan nistyat daryat tata karma pravatanat sangachagat chatovrite sadvi bhakti prasidyati. To always be enthusiastic, to be have confidence, faith in the words of guru, sadhu, and shastra, and to have patience if it takes some time and the result is not coming at once, to not lose our enthusiasm and confidence, even though some time is elapsing. This is called patience, etc. So these are the qualities whereby bhakti becomes successful. These will have to be accepted. So these two aspects are part of cheshtarup, called sadhanrup, and then the other aspect of cheshtarup or endeavor is called karyarup. When one's sadhan has become advanced up to the stage of bhav, then all the activities such as Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu, Smaranam, they're undertaken not as Indriya Vyapar or Indriya Prerana, activities instigated from the level of the senses, but rather hearing, chanting and remembering is taken up as a reaction to one's internal transcendental feelings, one's spontaneous love for Chaitanya Mahaprabhu or Radha Krishna. So this is called the Karya Rup. Then if we go to the Bhavarup aspect of the word Shilanam, there are two parts. One is called Stai Bhavarup and one is called Sanchari Bhavarup. The Stai Bhavarup refers to the emotions that one feels which are the foundational ecstatic mood of love for Sri Krishna. It's of five types: Shanta, Dasya, Sakya, Vatsalya and Madhurya. Neutral, passive adoration, and superior to that, the mood of a servant, superior to that, the mood of a friend, superior to that, the mood of a parent, and the supermost emotion, the mood of a beloved of Sri Krishna. So this is called the Stai Bhav Rup. Within the ocean of the Stai Bhav, one's foundational ecstasy, some transitory assisting emotions like waves will rise and fall, That is called Sanchari Bhav Rup. There are 33 types of Sanchari Bhavs. So all revolving around the word Shilanam is the entire explanation of bhakti for those in the stage of sadhan, in the stage of bhav, and also in the stage of prem. So Rupa Goswami Pada has written Krishna Anushilanam, that this cultivation of endeavors should be not shilanam, only a cultivation of endeavor, but rather Anushilanam. The word Anu indicates continuous, unbroken. So we can see to what degree we have progressed in pure bhakti by how much our absorption in devotional service is interrupted by things other than devotional service. And when our practices are uninterrupted, then it can be called Anushilanam. The word Anu, apart from indicating Nirantar Jamai, continuousness, also indicates Anugatya, that bhakti is an activity which is performed under the guidance of the one's superiors. Whether it's in this world, the conditioned souls in this world must take up devotional service, not independently, but under the guidance of a liberated spiritual master. If they're not under the guidance of a liberated spiritual master, their activities, though they may be performing hearing and chanting, remembering, they cannot be called Uttama Bhakti. They cannot fit into the definition given by Rupa Goswami Pad. So in this world, and also out of this world, in the eternal spiritual world, there we see that all the Rati Manjari is under the guidance of Rupa Manjari, is under the guidance of Lalita Sakhi, is under the guidance of Radhika, and all are serving Krishna. And therefore, the principle of Anugatya, or being under guidance, is universal and all-pervading in the spiritual world, and it extends down to this world, so we'd better get used to it here. Then, Anuko Yena Krishna Anu Shilanam. The word Anu, Krishna Anu, also indicates that devotional service is in connection with Krishna. So it may be directly for Krishna or for a person who is related to Krishna. So because the conditioned soul in this world, it has not realized his relationship with Krishna, his devotional activities only become devotional when he performs them for the pleasure of a devotee who actually is established in a relationship with Krishna. So Srila Narottam Das Thakur said, Shri Guru Charana Padma Kevala Bhakati Sadhama, that the repository of devotional service, there is an exclusive repository of devotional service. It is not available anywhere else. It is only available at the lotus feet of one's divine holy teacher, the spiritual master, Shri Guru. So we come to the word Anukulyena. Anukulyena is sometimes taken to mean for the pleasure of Shri Krishna. But actually we find that this conception is a mistranslation, is not complete. Why? Because in the pastimes of Krishna, we see that Mother Yashoda, sometimes she binds him with a rope, sometimes she may just twist his ear, and she may give him, inflict some discipline upon him, which at the moment, at that time, for Krishna, is something that he doesn't want. It's not something that's very pleasing to him. Krishna may weep and cry and have a tantrum or do some more mischief in order to avenge the discipline inflicted upon him by his mother. So we see that the question comes, is the discipline inflicted by Mother Yashoda, is it bhakti or not? It must be, even though it's not immediately pleasing to Krishna. So the word Anukulyena means Pratikul Bhav Rahita. Devotional service is devoid of any antagonistic mood towards Krishna. On the other hand, we see that Chanura and Mustika, the wrestlers of Kamsa, they were fighting with Krishna, they were trying to kill him, and Krishna was really relishing that fight. It gave great pleasure to him. Yet the activities of Chanura and Mustika, the wrestlers, though it gave pleasure to Krishna, it can't be called bhakti because it was not Anukulyena, meaning Pratikul Bhav Rahita. It was not devoid of antagonism, but rather it was completely infused with antagonism. They wanted to kill Krishna. So if we take the word Anukulyena to mean for the pleasure of Krishna, then there would have been a defect in the definition of Rupa Goswami. One defect, that defect would have been avyakti dosh. In other words, the definition is too narrow and excludes things which are included in bhakti, such as the services of Madhya Shoda, or it would have been guilty of ativyapti dosh, the definition being too broad and including things which are not actually devotion, such as the beatings of the powerful wrestlers Chanura and Mustika. So when bhakti is performed by body, mind and words and feelings of the heart, devoid of any antagonistic mood, continuously under guidance, for the benefit, ultimate benefit and welfare of Krishna, this is called bhakti uttama. The word uttama means that this bhakti is uttama, above darkness. It's above the material world of the prakriti, the modes of material nature. So the word uttama bhakti indicates that there must be things, there must be a type of bhakti which is not uttama. So that is when bhakti is not uttama, that means the devotional activities are mixed with the modes of material nature. So that is called arop siddha bhakti, sangha siddha bhakti, and the, that sort
of,
in this way, on Gurudev's order, we conclude this brief discussion of the nature of uttama bhakti.
Very good. You heard about this. Now you can judge yourself. Truly, you are following this bhakti or not. You know, Dhruva, he did bhakti. He meditated Narayan, Vaibhav Prakash of Krishna. And he saw, he took darshan even, but his bhakti is not pure, because he has some anyabhilash, and he has some worldly desire also, some attachment to her mother, his mother, so not pure bhakti. In regard, we see Prahlad Maharaj, his bhakti is pure. Bhisham Pitama, pure bhakti. Sanak Sanandan Sanatan in first stage, pure bhakti, but not uttama bhakti. Not. Prahlad Maharaj is Bhagavat, uttam Bhagavat. For vaidhi bhakti, we take him. We must follow him. But for Raganuga, giving regard them, him, Prahlad, Bhisham Pitama, Paul Kumar, even Sukhdev Goswami in his first career, we will give respect to them. But keeping them aside, you should go forward. Then uttama bhakti will be, otherwise not. One thing also, Anukullena, he told so many explanations. Anu nairantarjimai, anu anugatyamai. What is the meaning of anugatya? Can you say? What is it? What is that?
Anugacha means to be completely under the guidance of the spiritual master or one's guide. Also related to Sharanagati, that one has completely surrendered, one has passed the stage of Nishtha and is entering into the stage of Ruchi, taste for chanting. So this would indicate that one is coming.
Has any disciple right to correct his Gurudev words? Understand?
To correct his words.
Correct his explanation, correct his words, correct his writings, correct anything, has he right or not?
I think it would depend on the circumstances.
Huh?
I think it would depend upon the circumstances.
No, never. In any case, anukullena. If anything that you are not understanding, you can ask him.
Clarify.
In what line? Oh, if I am qualified, then you may tell. Not more than that. Any disciple, if he thinks that I am more superior, I can think more, I know better than my Gurudev, then he is demon. Really he is demon. Before accepting Guru, he can think that whether he is qualified or not, first, at that time. And if he has accepted, then he should obey. He has no right to change anything of it. Guru words, then where is anukullena? You know, Vyasadeva was Narayan, Shaktavesh avatar. No? And Guru was who? Narayana. He totally followed. Why I'm sad he did not knew? Oh Gurudev, you know why I am sad. Narada Rishi did not wrote so many scriptures and other things. Thus there, whereas divided four Vedas, made Brahma Sutra, Mahabharata, and so many things more than Narada. Narada has done only Narada Pancharatra. But what his Gurudev told, it was all right not to change. He had no authority to do. So we should try to follow Gurudev in this line. If any doubt comes, you can go directly and beg him. Very politely you should ask, and he will remove your all doubts. Always be careful, otherwise this is namaparad. Second, Guru Ravagya, always. We sometimes misguide it, but our Shastra tells all these things clearly. What is written? Anna abhilasita sunnam jnana karmadhyan nabhritam anukullena krishna anushilanam bhakti. Oh, it should be applied also on Guru. On Guru. It has been told Krishna and his Krishna and his manifestations. Also Gurudev. It should be applied. So we should try to understand all these meanings and follow. I have come only to remind you all. Don't be weak. And try to follow all these things, and we should begin from beginning. Adav Saddha Tata Sadhu Sangha. I told you. I thought in Malaysia, I told the what subject should I deal here. Then I myself decided that in Jagannath Puri we have explained somewhat about Rai Ramanand Sambhad. In Rai Ramanand Sambhad, nothing is left. From very beginning, you cannot think. Very beginning. From Varnasram Dharma. And what? Up to Radha mood. Manjari mood, what I told in morning. Everything is discussed there. And how to have the process also. So, I thought that in brief, we will discuss here how many? 4 days or 5 days? Four more days. I will try that we should discuss
briefly on this subject. You should also be prepared. So, Mahaprabhu went to south. There were so many purposes. Outwardly, purpose was to know about whereabout of his brother, Vishwarup Prabhu. What became? And he went there, discovered that he has left his body, this world. He met with Raya Ramananda, and everywhere in South, he made all Vaishnavas by preaching. Told them, be Guru and preach what I told you. You should tell Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram. And tell him or to preach that. But one condition, and condition was, don't meet, take meat, eggs, wine, all these things. And you should chant and be good. Someone questioned, then Guru Abhiman will come, or it will not come. You should be sincere. So we should try to follow. He went to various temples. He went to Shetbandha Rameshram, Kanyakumari. Kanyakumari means Durga. Shetbandha Rameshwaram, Tanjore, here and the same Shiv temple everywhere. But everywhere he was dancing. Dancing. And all were dancing with him. And he was singing also. Why? Why he was singing and dancing? In Tanjore, Shiv temple, 1008 Shiva Vigraha. Very biggest temple. Even more higher than Puri temple. And there is a biggest stone, more than 1,000 tons perhaps. And how they kept there? No one knows. And he went there and began to dance and sing. Why? Anywhere he used to go, he did not saw their form or anything. But what he saw? Everywhere Krishna is Purti. What is written? Sthaur jangam dekhe, nakhe, dekhe tar murti. Sarvast puray tahar iste devas. Sarvast. How? He saw Shiv, Mahadev. And Mahadev always serving Krishna like Atma Bhav, Hari Har Ek Atma. Like Gopishwar Mahadev. And he began to meditate on Krishna. Yes. A Uttamadhikari sees grasses, but not grasses. What? Who made it? Who made it? And at once goes to Krishna. So everything reminds him, Krishna, Krishna. And if more Uttamadhikari, then he will think that, oh, all reminding Radhika. He will see Krishna and what? Remember, she is controlled by Radhika. Her love and affection is so hard. So, Uttamadhikari sees. So, everywhere he went, preached Hari name.
and all were inspired by them, they became Vaishnava. Thus, he came to Raya Ramananda place, Godavari. Now, what place? Vijayawada, Rajmundry, Kabur, where Raya Ramananda used to be, Kabur. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was sitting. He had taken bath and he was meditating something. How beautiful was he? Was himself so beautiful. Taking the beauty, intrinsic beauty of Radhika. So how beautiful. And what meditating? For which he had descended. And saffron cloth matches. Why took saffron cloth? And rock collar. And then, in the meantime, king with drum, with thousands of pandit reciting Veda shlok, Sri Sukta, Purushukta, and all other shloks. And then he took bath also. And then from distance he saw, who is that? Sannyasi. Thinking, hey, stop all the Brahmins there, you should wait here. And his palanquin, oh, he stopped there. Alone, with only dhoti, only one, he did an up covering. In a simple way, without shoes and palatial dresses, he came. And he went to Mahaprabhu and thinking. Like, Mahaprabhu opened his eyes and saw. The two eyes, he came four. And then Mahaprabhu asked, are you Ramananda? And then what? Oh, I am Sudra. I am Sam Sudra. And then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu at once embraced him. And he wanted to fell on the feet of Mahaprabhu. All the Brahmins from distance, they were watching. What doing they? This sannyasi is Brahmin. Because without Brahman being by born, but anyone cannot take sannyas. But our Goswami has opened the door for all. Otherwise, he should take birth in India and also in very high class of Brahmin family. Then he. So he must be Brahmin and he is sannyasi even. Why he is touching this Sudra? Raya Ramananda Sudra. Huh? Sudra, Rajbhavati Acharya Sudri, Udhari Kaistake Sudri Bhutta. He was in caste family. Caste is called Sudra. Because there are so many reasons. Anyhow, he told himself that I am Sudra. And all they thought that he is Sudra. So, they were thinking, why this sannyasi, being a Brahmin sannyasi, and what light coming from his body to high class. And why he touching this Shudra Ramananda? And Ramananda is very learned person, very grave. He is like a king, representative, governor general of Pratapadudra, and very learned, esquire. Why he now dancing and weeping and trembling? Ashtasattvic become. They could not understand that why. But actually, Raya Ramananda is not Sudra. Who is Sudra? Lamenting for mortal things. They are Sudra. If a sannyasi lamenting for his mother, father, for position, for anything, mortal thing, then sannyasi is not really a sannyasi, he is Sudra. And even a Sudra, like Vidur, Sudrani Mata, Narada in his first birth, he was from Sudrani Mata, mother. But if you will think that they were Sudra, then it is Nama Parad, Vaishnava Parad. We should not think like this. So Raya Ramananda was guru of sannyasi even. More than sannyasi, Mahaprabhu respected him. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told him, "Oh, I was in Jagannath Puri and Sarvam Bhattacharya was very kind to me. He told me that if you are going to south, you must meet Raya Ramananda. He is the lost Sima, limit of Prem Bhakti. At first I could not understand, but by the association of Mahaprabhu, he recognized who is Raya. Now he is appreciating and told that you must go there. And so I have come to you and I want to hear something from you." Raya Raman told, "Oh, in a form of sannyasi, really you are not sannyasi. Sarvam Bhattacharya was very kind to me and perhaps that is why he has sent you to me. I want that you should stay here for some more days and try to correct me or inform me." So thus at that day up to this, Mahaprabhu told that in evening I will wait for you. You must come. And thus Mahaprabhu went to a Brahmin who invited him to take Mahaprasadam. And Mahaprabhu went there, took Prasadam, and evening he was. Gaur Prema, one Kirtan Krishnadas.